Hello and welcome to another video. Today we are going to talk about pituitary adenomas. So what are pituitary adenomas? An adenoma is a benign tumor of epithelial cell origin located in the pituitary gland. Pituitary adenomas are the most common cause of hyperpituitarism, which is a condition when there's too much pituitary gland hormones. Pituitary adenomas are very common, although most of them don't get discovered throughout life. They're usually found in adults and they can be divided into microadenomas that are smaller than 1 cm and macroadenomas that are bigger than 1 cm. We can also divide them into functional and non-functioning adenomas. Functional adenomas are tumors that produce an excessive amount of hormone or sometimes even 2 hormones, and because of that they can be often clinically recognized. Non-functioning adenomas don't produce any hormone, so they often can't be clinically recognized. But if you have a non-functioning macroadenoma, again, a tumor larger than 1 cm that doesn't produce any hormones, it can of course grow. And you know that there's not a lot of space around the pituitary. There's optic chiasm, there's the cavernous sinus with cranial nerves, and of course, if the tumor gets big enough, it can start to impinge on them. So then, even though the patient has no typical symptoms of hormonal disbalances, he can suffer from headaches, vision problems, and much more. Okay, so we divided pituitary adenomas into functional and non-functioning, and microadenomas and macroadenomas. We can also divide them on the basis of the hormone that they produce excessively. If they produce prolactin, then we talk about a lactotroph adenoma or a prolactinoma. If they produce somatotropine, the growth hormone, then somatotroph adenoma. If they produce adrenocorticotropic hormone, then corticotroph adenoma. And we also have a gonadotroph adenoma that produces excessive amounts of follicle-stimulating hormone or luteinizing hormone, and thyrotroph adenomas that produce thyroid-stimulating hormone. But these two are very rare, so we're not going to spend too much time talking about them in this video. Now that we've covered all the general information we needed, let's take a look at each individual type and let's figure out together what will happen if there's too much of the hormone it secretes in the body. We'll start with lactotroph adenomas, or as we said, prolactinomas. Prolactinomas produce excessive amounts of prolactin, which cause hyperprolactinemia, so a condition when there's too much prolactin in the body. Prolactinomas are the most frequent type of functioning pituitary adenoma, and they can quite differ in size. Now, let's talk about what happens to our bodies when there's a prolactinoma. The way I like to do this is to first realize what the hormone normally does, and then try to figure out what could happen if there's something wrong. That way I think it makes more sense and it's much easier to remember. So let's see. What we know is that prolactin inhibits ovulation after childbirth. How? It inhibits secretion of gonadotropin-releasing hormone, which regulates the secretion of luteinizing and follicle-stimulating hormone. So when there's no gonadotropin-releasing hormone, there's also no luteinizing and follicle-stimulating hormone, and new oocytes cannot develop. Physiologically, this inhibition lasts until a few weeks after the end of nursing, and then things go back to normal. But in our case, we have high levels of prolactin all the time, not just after childbirth. So what could happen? Well, women are going to suffer from amenorrhea, the absence of menstruation or even infertility. Remember, no luteinizing and follicle-stimulating hormone, so no oocytes. Okay, so that's one thing. Another thing prolactin is responsible for is milk production, and we know that it, for example, stimulates milk secretion during breastfeeding. The way this works is that during breastfeeding, sensory receptors in the nipple get stimulated, and this causes more prolactin to be secreted. Now, if we have so much prolactin already, we don't have to wait for the nipples to be stimulated, and what can happen is galactorrhea, which means that milk unexpectedly leaks from the breasts. In men, prolactin causes decreased libido and also partial or even complete impotence or infertility. This is more tricky because we don't yet understand all the effects prolactin has on men, but it seems that it could play a role in testosterone secretion and spermatogenesis, which would then make sense. Finally, how should we treat a person that has a prolactinoma? Usually it's either surgery, when we remove the tumor, or you can treat the patient with bromocriptine, which is a dopamine agonist. Why dopamine agonist? Well, this also makes sense because dopamine is prolactin's most important inhibitory factor. So when you get dopamine, you can inhibit prolactin secretion, and that's what we want, right? Using the same method, let's continue with somatotroph adenomas. Somatotroph adenomas produce excessive amounts of growth hormone or somatotropin, and they are the second most frequent type of functioning pituitary adenomas. Now, somatotropin has three major effects. It promotes growth, it helps to utilize fat as a source of energy, and it also has a diabetogenic effect. I'll explain what that means, because this one may just not be that clear. Growth hormone does two things. It decreases the absorption of glucose in skeletal muscle and adipose tissue, and it also increases glucose production by the liver. The result? Well, you have more glucose in the blood, and this means that we're going to need more insulin. And you know that if someone has diabetes, they have a very similar problem, high concentration of glucose and not enough insulin, or the tissue is resistant to it. So this creates something very similar, and that's why it's called diabetogenic. Good, moving on to pathophysiology. If we have high levels of somatotropin in children, so that means before the apophyses have closed, then we talk about gigantism. The child is going to get taller and taller. That's quite straightforward. If it happens after the apophyses have closed, well then, there's not much possibility of the patient getting taller. But their organs can get bigger, and so can their hands and feet. And this diabetogenic effect we just talked about, well, the patient can suffer from an actual diabetes, because there's just going to be so much glucose, okay? The treatment options are quite similar to prolactinomas, either a surgery or you can give the patient somatostatin analogues. Somatostatin is the same thing as dopamine for prolactin. It inhibits growth hormone's production, and that's again exactly what we want here. Finally, we have corticotroph adenomas that produce excessive adrenocorticotropic hormone. Adrenocorticotropic hormone stimulates the synthesis and secretion of adrenal cortical hormones, most importantly cortisol. So if there's a tumor, there's too much adrenocorticotropic hormone, there's too much cortisol, and we get hypercortisolism, also known as Cushing disease. Well, Cushing syndrome and Cushing disease are very popular topics, and they deserve a separate video. However, we're still going to figure out together at least some of the things that are going to happen if there's too much cortisol in the body. So what does cortisol do? First thing is that cortisol stimulates gluconeogenesis, in other words, the synthesis of glucose. Pathophysiology. A lot of cortisol means a lot of synthesized glucose, and we get hyperglycemia or even diabetes. Cortisol also suppresses the immune system and has several anti-inflammatory effects. That can be a good thing, but as you can guess, patients suffering from hypercortisolism will have a very difficult time with wound healing. Another thing is that cortisol upregulates alpha-1 adrenergic receptors in arterioles. Upregulation simply means that there's more of these receptors. Now, why are they important? They're important for catecholamines, so epinephrine and norepinephrine, that increase blood pressure. So it's no surprise that the patient may perhaps suffer from hypertension, high blood pressure. Finally, cortisol also inhibits bone formation, so the patient can suffer from osteoporosis. And we could go on and on, but as I said, this topic deserves a separate video, so just a little warning that these are not all the symptoms that you would find in patients suffering from Cushing disease. Before we finish, I'd like to say a few things about gonadotroph and thyrotroph adenomas, which, as I said, are very, very rare. Gonadotroph adenomas produce excessive amount of follicle-stimulating or luteinizing hormone, or it can be even both of them. But they are often non-functioning, and even if they are functional, they usually don't cause any recognizable symptoms, so it really doesn't make sense for us to spend time on them. And thyrotroph adenomas produce excessive thyroid-stimulating hormone that stimulates production and secretion of thyroid hormones. So you could theoretically end up with hyperthyroidism. Again, a condition when there's too much thyroid hormones, but this is very rare. Okay, so I think this is more than enough for pituitary adenomas. I hope you found this video helpful and that it made sense. For more videos, please subscribe. Thank you for watching, and until next time, don't forget that medicine can be easy.